Good morning, it's January the 29th, and today we are on chapter 26 of Acts, and we're coming to the end of the chapter, and we're looking at verses 19 to 32. So, let's begin. So then, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the vision from heaven, first to those in Damascus, then to those in Jerusalem and in all Judea, and then to the Gentiles. I preached that they should repent and turn to God and demonstrate their repentance by their deeds. That is why some Jews seized me in the temple courts and tried to kill me. But God has helped me to this very day, so I stand here and testify to small and great alike. I am saying nothing beyond what the prophets and Moses said would happen, that the Messiah would suffer, and as the first to rise from the dead, would bring the message of light to his own people and to the Gentiles. At this point, Festus interrupted Paul's defence. You are out of your mind, Paul, he shouted. Your great learning is driving you insane. I am not insane, most excellent Festus, Paul replied. What I am saying is true and reasonable. The king is familiar with these things, and I can speak freely to him. I am convinced that none of this has escaped his notice, because it was not done in a corner. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? I know you do. Then Agrippa said to Paul, do you think that in such a short time you can persuade me to be a Christian? Paul replied, short time or long, I pray to God that not only you, but all who are listening to me today may become what I am, except for these chains. The king rose, and with him the governor and Bernice and those sitting with them. After they left the room, they began saying to one another, this man is not doing anything that deserves death or imprisonment. Agrippa said to Festus, this man could have been set free if he had not appealed to Caesar. So we've got here Paul saying to King Agrippa his story, explaining his defence and sharing what happened to him when Jesus appeared to him on the road to Damascus, and explaining that he went from being the persecutor to now being the persecuted, and just basically explaining his history and sharing his defence. And we've got Festus interrupting him, saying basically he thinks that Paul's mad, that he's gone insane. But we've got in 1 Corinthians 1:18, Paul himself says, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. So Festus is a classic example of somebody who's got no idea. He hasn't seen the truth. He hasn't seen the light. He doesn't accept the gospel. And so it just seems complete foolishness and madness to him. But Paul speaks freely to Agrippa. And he also knows that he can share all these things because they haven't been done, as it says in verse 26, they haven't been done in a corner. Paul's talking about true historical facts. He's talking about the death and the resurrection of Jesus, which are true, based on historical events. And King Agrippa would have known about all of these things. And then we come to this interesting thing that King Agrippa says to Paul. In verse 28, do you think that in such a short time you can persuade me to be a Christian? And in the New King James Version, it says, you almost persuade me to become a Christian. And it just makes me wonder, why almost? What was stopping him? What was stopping him from becoming a Christian? Was it his companion, Bernice? Maybe if she didn't also want to become a Christian, that he wouldn't want to give her up, he wouldn't want to make these sacrifices to his life that he'd have to make. Because we've got Paul saying, I preach that all should repent and turn to God and demonstrate their repentance by their deeds. To repent is to turn away from things that we're doing wrong. Was it because he didn't want to be seen as mad, like Paul was called by Festus, saying that he was insane, and Festus was listening as well, and it was a bit of a pride thing, he didn't want to be seen as mad. And there's this quote by Spurgeon, and it says, oh, that men were wise enough to see that suffering for Christ is honour, that loss for truth is gain, that the truest dignity rests in wearing the chain upon the arm rather than endure the chain upon the soul. And we've got that Paul says that he wishes that all who are listening would become what he is, except for these chains. But you'd rather wear the chain on your arm than endure the chain upon your soul, as Spurgeon said. And it just makes me think, you know, are there people that we're friends with, that we've got a relationship with, that we've been sharing the gospel with and praying for, but they're just almost. They're not willing to make that jump. They're not willing to make the sacrifice that following the way requires to live a pure and holy life. You know, or is there a situation where someone's asked you about what you believe and you've shared it, but they're like, they're not willing to take that step of faith and to become a Christian. And it just makes you wonder, why? What is it? And is it that sacrifice, as I said, of not wanting to give things up that maybe King Agrippa didn't want to do? So it's praying, it's persevering in prayer, because it says, I pray to God that not only you who are listening to me today, it's not us who helps them to become a Christian in that sense. We do all the explaining the gospel, we lead them to Jesus, but it's actually God who does the work in their hearts. We've got to be obedient to what God calls us to do in sharing the gospel, but trusting him to make that change in their hearts. So if there is somebody that you're praying for, I really encourage you to continue praying for them and continue sharing the gospel with them and praying that they would accept what Jesus did for them and to make that sacrifice for the faith, because it's totally worth it. And the gift of eternal life is totally worth it, and not to have that chain upon your soul, as Spurgeon said. So yeah, have a lovely day, and I'll see you soon. Bye.